Is there anyone left running Ferguson? We dissect the local ripple effects of the latest unrest and stunningly swift changes in government now underway. Plus, they want his head, but the head of the Missouri Republican Party is refusing to resign. Is he being unfairly blamed in the suicide of State Auditor Tom Schweich? Plus, Johnson County leaders defy vocal critics to approve a $20 million plan to breathe life into one of the county's most iconic and politically divisive buildings. And Brownback in Missouri, taking the Kansas show on the road. Welcome, everyone. I'm Nick Haines. While an orange ball being thrown into a hoop at Sprint Center represents the most important story of the week for many, we are here to track all the other important issues you need to know about on both sides of state line. Plus, given the nature of some of our topics, we're shaking up the panel. Patrick Tuohey is joining us. He's a former pollster and political communications consultant who now works for the Show Me Institute, which played host to Governor Brownback's Missouri speech. Familiar faces also with us, Kansas City Star political reporter, columnist and blogger Dave Helling, Eric Wesson from the Call newspaper, and Star editorial page writer Barbara Shelley. Now, two police officers were shot outside the Ferguson, Missouri police station this week, just hours after the city's embattled police chief Thomas Jackson announced he was resigning. Jackson was the latest in a slew of officials to step down since a scathing Justice Department report accused Ferguson leaders of unfairly targeting blacks with fines to raise money. Also out is the city manager, the city clerk, two police supervisors, and Ferguson Municipal Court Judge Ronald Brockmeyer. The Missouri Supreme Court has stepped in and assigned a state appeals court judge to oversee municipal cases in Ferguson, saying extraordinary action was needed to restore trust in the court system there. But why all these resignations now? Why not after the shooting? Was there an expectation that somehow this Justice Department report would look at what was happening in Ferguson more favorably? And why at this point in time, as change was being so visibly seen, the shootings of police officers in Ferguson, Eric?
Well, the shootings, I think that's a whole nother conversation, and it's a whole different set of people that might have participated in that. And the question why it took so long, nobody knows. I think they thought it was going to get better. I think they thought it was something that would last a week or two and then blow over and everything would be back to normal. I don't think that officials there expected it to last this long and for the Justice Department to go in such detail with their investigation.
They weren't expecting a more favorable report, Barbara. Is that the deal?
Well, I think he's exactly right. You know, Ferguson had never been the subject of a Justice Department report prior to this, and, you know, nobody knew what that was going to look like. And, you know, people tend to, you know, dig their heels in. That police chief, you know, dug his heels in for months and said he wanted to ride it out.
And we have the Missouri Supreme Court saying we're now going to have a state judge come in and hear every case that's coming before the Ferguson Municipal Court there. Is that an unprecedented move, Dave?
Relatively unprecedented and applauded almost universally, in part because the municipal court system in most states, and certainly in the state of Missouri, is really subject to some criticism. I mean, it's a part-time job. The Justice Department report reveals repeatedly how tickets were fixed for friends, for white friends of the judge and the prosecutor, and it was a very much a sort of an agreement that violations weren't a problem, but boy, if you were an African American and you got caught in the maw of the municipal court and couldn't pay your fine, you would get more fines, jail time. It was just an extraordinary explication of how justice is administered in that community. And so for that reason, there was almost universal support for the Supreme Court's
move. But Patrick, for the Supreme Court to come in and appoint a state judge, though, to hear all of the cases?
Well, I don't envy anybody who's trying to figure out what to do next in Ferguson. Certainly legislation in Jeff City that targets Max Creek, that looks at the degree to which a city is benefiting financially from fines and fees that it's placing on its citizens, is welcome, and that's a problem statewide. But I think what Ferguson does next is going to take months, if not years.
You know, we had the Missouri Governor Jay Nixon come to Kansas City just recently and say, and look at what was happening in Ferguson after the Justice Department report, and said, you know, I quote here, you hope when you see something this jarring is that Ferguson is an outlier, but deep inside you, you know there are still challenges throughout our state. But did he name any names?
Well, he probably knew from when he was an attorney general, but no, he didn't name any names. But we know that Ferguson is not an isolated situation in the state of Missouri when it comes to small police municipalities. I think that one of the things that we should look toward in the coming months is possibly conversations about disbanding that entire police department. Because you remove one person doesn't mean that you've changed the culture that's operated within that department. So I think that that's one thing to look for. Also, the Missouri Supreme Court coming in, taking over the court. What about the people that have already been somewhat violated? How do you make those people whole again? Because they were giving people tickets for jaywalking. They were fining them again for not showing up in court. And some of the report, and I read two-thirds of it, it was like they were giving people times to come to court when they were like 7 or 8:15 in the evening to come to court. Who remembers, I got to be in court at 8:15?
There was one example of a police officer who stopped an African-American, asked for a name. The guy gave his name as Mike. His driver's license said Michael. He was cited for incorrectly giving his name to the police officer. That kind of thing was apparently routine in Ferguson. And you're right, Nick, you do get the suspicion that it isn't just limited to Ferguson. Because, and this is what we really need to, I think about and address. While no one really likes having police authorities in their lives, the reality is the us versus them mentality of residents to police officers in communities all over the area continues to grow. Part of that is the militarization of the police, but part of it is, I think, an attitude that in some senses police departments become occupiers rather than public servants. And that really needs some significant focus in the months and years ahead if we're not going to repeat another Ferguson, it seems to me.
The Missouri Attorney General's office was naming names this week when it released the names of cities in the state that failed to submit a report detailing the racial composition of those stopped by police as required by state law, failing to supply that data even after being sent 4 notices, according to Attorney General Chris Costa. Was the Claycomo Police Department, that's where the Kansas City Ford Motor Plant is located and next to Worlds of Fun. We set up these laws, but what's the price on police departments who don't follow through, Barbara?
I haven't heard that there's been any penalties. I think the Attorney General's office just keeps sending them notices. Now that might change at this point.
I think that one of the things is that they hold their state funding. When Costa became Attorney General, one of the first reports that he did, I asked him, what's the problem? How do we solve it? Because this has been going on. And he said the legislation needs to put teeth in the law because there's nothing that he can really do other than file some paperwork to hold up their state funding. But he can only do that for so long. And after they do that, then they start taking money from other areas like Medicaid, education, to make up the gap with the education that those municipalities have.
Well, Kansas City Congressman Emanuel Cleaver introduces a bill this week in Congress making it illegal for cities to enforce criminal or traffic laws solely to raise revenue. Cleaver says he wants to end the practice of cities using law enforcement as a cash register, as he put it, which disproportionately affects the poor. But what then would constitute legitimate law enforcement work aimed at cracking down on criminals? And when would police activity be viewed as for revenue generation purposes only, Barbara?
Yeah, that's an interesting question because it's not as clear-cut as it sounds. I mean, what Ferguson was doing was outrageous, and I'm sure that goes on in other cities too. But you take a city like Lone Jack, which is a small municipality, they're there by Highway 50, where people just zip down Highway 50, and their story is, we need to be out there giving tickets so people slow down, because this is a real safety hazard, and they do have some bad intersections there.
And Kansas City did have the red light cameras, and some people complained, of course, that was really about revenue generation, not about safety, Patrick.
If we explode the issue and talk about economic justice in poor towns and in poor parts of towns, then Kansas City has a beam in its own eye, because from our tax structure to our TIF policy to our transportation structure, we have for years up until this last year been taking money from poor and working class people to benefit the wealthy parts of town. So certainly this is a problem if towns are generating fees and revenue from the poor and using the police to generate stuff. But the problem only gets bigger the more and more you talk about it.
And Nick, one more thing on that with Cleaver. I think people are going to say that's more of a state issue, a state law issue than a federal law issue.
Okay. What about the protests that we're now seeing in Ferguson once again, and on the campaign trail here in Kansas City? Mayor James has been speaking out, and we had also the police chief here saying, we haven't had any of those circumstances here in Kansas City. We have good relationships with the community. Is that really the case, Eric?
I think so. I think it is a pretty good relationship between the police department and the city of Kansas City. There's communication there. You see police out. They live in Kansas City. And one of the things in Ferguson was the police worked there, but they lived in the surrounding area, so that there wasn't that connection. But there are minor issues, but they're nothing like as big as Ferguson. I think Forte being in the community, the deputy chiefs being in the community has helped with that relationship.
Missouri State Auditor and Republican gubernatorial candidate Tom Schweich took his own life 2 weeks ago, and now there's a growing campaign to blame the head of the Missouri GOP, John Hancock, for his untimely demise. They claim Hancock began a whispering campaign that Schweich was Jewish and that allegedly enraged Schweich so much it pushed him over the edge. While suicide is complicated and no one knows what was in the Missouri auditor's head when he decided life was not worth living anymore, that has not stopped calls for Hancock's head. They want him to resign as head of the state GOP. But is there any evidence that's going to happen, Dave Helling?
No, not yet, although I don't think the story is completely played out. But you did see yesterday, on Thursday, many of the members of the Republican establishment in Missouri rushing to John Hancock's defense, saying, look, we know him, he's not bigoted. He would not have started an anti-Semitic whisper campaign. Now, I do believe that John Hancock is almost Clinton-esque in his statements on this issue, because in essence what he said is, I don't remember ever saying that Tom Schweich was Jewish, but if I did, I'm sorry I said it. I mean, that's almost, you know, come on, tell us whether you use the words or not, and then we can parse whether you meant them in an anti-Semitic way or not, which is a legitimate issue. And certainly Tom Schweich's reaction was, as you suggest, over the edge. But if he's to clear this up completely, I do think John Hancock will have to come clean at some point.
But most of us have never heard John Hancock in his own words. But he did speak out publicly for the first time this week since the Missouri auditor's death, appearing on KMOX radio in St. Louis.
I don't remember ever having a conversation with someone about that, but I could have. I have all kinds of conversations about political candidates, you know, and I may point out that you know, Chris Christie's got a little girth going on there. I mean, you know, you talk about these people, and in a political context, and it is possible that I said to somebody that Tom was Jewish because I thought Tom was Jewish. And what I know for certain is that after Senator Danforth informed me that Tom was Episcopalian, I would never have said that he's Jewish ever again.
Okay, Patrick Tuohey, I mean, did that help or hurt him?
As Dave said, it keeps the issue alive, and I think it's going to be alive for a number of weeks. And what the Republicans and John Hancock have to figure out is, regardless of what happened in the past, what's the best way to go forward? And if any party leader is saddled with something like this, it may become, regardless of the truth, it may become too great for the party to handle.
Barbara.
Well, it's probable that John Hancock told at least one or two people that Schweich was Jewish, because he's saying, I thought he was Jewish. And I wonder why he thought Tom Schweich was Jewish, because John Hancock's specialty is candidate research, and he worked on Schweich's first campaign. So that is a very puzzling part of this.
But in a longer part of that interview, he then says, well, I never did the whole bio on him, so I never pulled that information. But there was a letter in the Kansas City Star saying, so what difference does it make anyway, even if he was Jewish? Does that in any way destroy his electability in the state of Missouri? I mean, does that have a negative effect today in the state of Missouri if you're Jewish?
I can't imagine it does. Our Secretary of State is Jewish. Senator Blunt's wife is Jewish. I don't know that this is a big deal, but it was enough to bother Tom Schweich, and we're talking about it now.
Eric.
One of the things that I hope this opens the door for is to examine how political campaigns are run, because some of these campaigns are just blatantly slimy. And I think that one of the things that, you know, State Representative Bonnie Mims introduced some legislation to deal with political bullying. And when we get into situations like that, we don't get real good candidates, because people say, I don't want to be scrutinized the way that some of these things are. And some of the statements aren't true, as in this case, if he did say that or not. But some of the bullying tactics in these political
campaigns. You just wrote a column about that, Barbara.
Well, yeah, I said it's, you know, unfortunate this question of the Jewish allegations are murky. and they kind of distract from a much more clear-cut issue, which is this campaign ad that ran, you know, just so all the Republicans would hear it driving into Kansas City for their Lincoln days, and so Tom Schweich would hear it.
Yeah, but just so we're clear, you will hear people say what Barb just said, which was that was over the line. But I don't think we clearly understand why Tom Schweich would respond to that kind of campaigning with suicide. Right. Anger, frustration, withdrawal from the race, all those other things. Those are legitimate, practical responses to that kind of campaigning. But suicide is just an inexplicable act in almost every way, Nick. And so it's possible we'll never know what the direct linkage was between that ad or even the Jewish allegation to this act.
And I think we've got to be very careful as to how we respond, because these are First Amendment priorities. These are things people should be allowed to say, no matter how ugly it is. And by the way, ugly campaigning and name-calling go back to the campaigns of Adams and Jefferson. This is an American tradition, for better or worse, and we need to be very careful that in trying to address it, we don't make things worse.
Well, to be clear, Nick, I'm not saying an ad was responsible for Schweich's suicide or what was responsible for Tom Schweich's suicide, but I thought John Ashcroft made a great point. This is 20 months before the Republican primary, and the party, a faction of the party, is running a hit piece, a very nasty hit piece, on a statewide office holder who's running for governor. You know, what is that all about?
And does the First Amendment cover telling a lie on somebody? Or is it just your right to speech? Or can you lie on people and then
hide
behind
But you're going to be a little careful about who gets to determine what is a lie and what isn't a lie in a political context.
Exactly.
I don't want judges making that decision.
If I'm not Jewish, then that's a lie.
That's exactly right. And yes, you are allowed to lie. And the campaign, I mean, part of what campaigns are about is who's telling the truth and how you look at the same issue. And the alternative is exactly that. Who decides what's a lie, and what do you do about it? And that, I think, if that's a solution, it is a worse solution than the problem it's meant to address.
Okay, the yelling about it is far greater than the pain that's here. The words of Kansas Governor Sam Brownback as he told a packed audience meeting in St. Louis that everything is fine in Kansas, despite the naysayers. Brownback was at the event organized by the Show Me Institute, labeled by the Star as a conservative think tank, funded by St. Louis billionaire Rex Singfield, and by the Topeka Capital Journal as a free market research group. The title of the event, What's the Real Story in Kansas? But why is the Kansas governor, first of all, taking his message to Missouri in the first place, Dave Helling?
Because Rex Singfield, the multimillionaire in St. Louis, and others have been interested in many years in dramatic reductions in the income tax levy in the state of Missouri and replacing it with a sales tax, which is generally the direction that Sam Brownback is going in Kansas. And so I think that the idea was to get Sam Brownback to go to St. Louis and to Jeff City and some other places and sort of push this idea to goad Missouri lawmakers into doing what Kansas
and
is.
And the speech was titled, What's the Real Story in Kansas, Patrick? And what did we learn about that real story that we're not getting right now?
Well, to read the story in the Star and elsewhere about what's going on in Kansas, you'd think that the oceans are boiling and the sky was on fire. But in fact, when you look at education funding this year is grown. It's grown every year for the last few years. But Kansas was in a problem. It was losing population, and it had to do something to spur growth. And so Kansas has seen over the last 2 years a growth in average wages. And I don't understand from a Missouri point of view what the story is here. In Missouri, we give away the same amount of money in tax in economic development tax credits as we collect in income tax. So we're not keeping the money either. We just decide who it goes to. In Kansas, what the governor did was said, let's lower taxes for everyone.
Let's just be clear, too, that if you're listening to Sam Brownback, tulips are blooming everywhere and butterflies are landing on your nose because things are great in Kansas. And is as always, Nick, the truth is in between. There are some places where things are going well, some where they are not. But what Sam Brownback has said is we need more time, and that to me is much more problematic.
But his quote was, there's more yelling than pain. Mm-hmm. Is that the case, Barbara?
Well, it depends on, you know, whether you're trying to run a school district, whether you're out there trying to keep the roads in shape, or whether you're Sam Brownback sitting in St. Louis talking to the Show Me Institute. And just to set the record straight on school funding, the amount of money looks like it's going up because Brownback has added pension money into the total sum. The amount of money that goes directly into classrooms for schools to run their day-to-day operations is at a lower level than it was in 2008.
Okay, just a point of clarification, because this week the Kansas legislature restores education cuts, according to the Brownback administration, proposed by the governor through a new block grant funding mechanism, adding, they say, more than $300 million to school districts over the next 3 years. In fact, Shawnee Mission says they're going to gain $8.8 million. The Kansas City, Kansas schools would net about $7.5 million more from the bill.
What we learned from a recent audit in St. Joseph, Missouri, is that you can shovel a whole bunch of money into a school system, but that doesn't mean that that money is getting to the classroom. There's a big problem in school administration with overhead and the growth of non-teacher staff. So it is a very difficult problem, but I think as far as what Kansas is getting, as far what the children are seeing in education spending is increasing, but the real problem is in the administration of those dollars once it gets to a district.
Can I just say quickly that from my point of view anyway, the problem with Governor Brownback's tax program is not necessarily that school spending has gone up or down, because you can make a case either way. And it's not really that taxes have gone up or down. You could make a case for that. My problem with Governor Brownback has always been that he promised that if you cut taxes, you wouldn't have to worry about school spending, because the supply side miracle would bring in more money and more jobs and more people. And the empirical evidence is that that has not worked in the state of
Kansas. Okay, so what is the response to that, Patrick?
Pure and simple.
Statewide, states with lower taxes grow faster.
But it's not happening, Patrick, in Kansas. It just isn't so.
In the aggregate, it happens. Now perhaps Kansas's situation is going to take more time.
Yeah.
But when you look at statewide, this is what happens. And as Missouri, we can't sit here when we're losing population, when we're losing jobs, when we're losing tax income, and say everything's fine.
The worst growth last year of any state was Alaska, which had a negative growth. It has neither an income tax or a sales tax. People move where the sun shines. They don't move necessarily because of tax policy.
Nick, and one thing, Kansas, I mean, this idea that everything is now fair and good and that these tax cuts were broad-based in Kansas, I mean, that's a fallacy, too. They heavily favor certain kinds of business, and in some cases, businesses and partnerships that benefit very wealthy people. And Kansas, as far as incentives, Patrick, I agree with you, Missouri gives away too many of these tax credits, but Kansas is the state that refuses to end the border war.
And a picture is worth a thousand words, whether it's tulips or sun is shining or all of those catchy phrases. Get in your car and drive through the urban core of Kansas City, Kansas, from Fifth Street to the Legends. They don't have grocery stores. There's abandoned blight everywhere, and I don't know how.
But the mayor of Winona County was just on this program saying they just put in a Krispy Kreme donuts there, so they just added some jobs. He did come on the program a couple of weeks ago.
That's just Patrick. What they need, something to help their diabetes grow.
Okay, all right.
For Kansas City, Missouri, we need an economic policy that, as Eric said, looks at the urban core and puts benefits and uses tax policies in the way it was used. But in Kansas City, what we do is we take money from the core, we take money regressively in sales taxes, and we put it along state line, we give it to Burns and Mack, we give it to Cerner. These are very wealthy companies headed by very wealthy people. And for us in Kansas City to cluck our tongues about a new policy in Kansas is too much.
Okay, on that score then, Kansas City has been ranked highly in a slew of surveys over the last year or so. Kansas City claimed the number two spot on the survey of the nation's happiest places to live. We've been named among America's most livable cities for people under 35. Yahoo named it one of the top 20 cities for hipsters. PC Magazine ranked Kansas City the number one high-tech city you'll want to call home. But worst-run city in America, ouch, Wallet Hub, has been poring over how tax dollars are spent all across the country and ranks Kansas City fifth worst in how efficiently it spends taxpayer dollars. The personal finance site pulled its figures from three main areas of big city budgets: education, police, and parks and recreation. What are we to make of this, Dave? Are we to take this seriously?
First of all, let me just endorse completely what Patrick said at the end there about incentives in Missouri. That's exactly right. We give away far too much money from the poor to the rich in this community. I've said that for 20 years. I think what these figures suggest are primarily related to education spending in Kansas City, Missouri, which I do think people find empirically has not yielded the results one would expect for all the money that's been spent in terms of educational achievement. And I don't think broadly many people will disagree with that. But Kansas City, Missouri has some waste too, arguably. And we'll go through this again next year when the earnings tax comes up for another vote, as it's expected to. to determine whether we're actually spending every dollar we need to spend where we should.
Well, I will agree that arguably Kansas City, Missouri wastes some money. But, you know, my colleague Michael Rathbone looked into these numbers and found that from what Wallet Hub put out there, we weren't able to recreate it. Their methodology wasn't clear enough. It may very well be true. But what all these studies say, I think, is Kansas City, as we all know, is a wonderful place to live. The top ratings we've gotten have talked about the people are nice, we've got great food, the climate is great. And those are all true.
We've got an orange ball going through a ring this week.
The climate is great today. This particular study looks at what the actual city is doing. And while we may not yet be able to verify their exact analysis, anecdotally, everybody in Kansas City knows that we're wasting money. We're wasting money on power and light. We're wasting money on transportation. We're wasting money by giving it away to people who don't need it. And meanwhile, we're having to cut city services.
Okay.
The city of fountains, we don't have enough money to run our own fountains.
Well, some taxpayers in Johnson County are wondering this week how far their elected leaders are efficiently spending their tax dollars. That after the Johnson County Commission votes to approve a $22 million plan to turn one of the county's most iconic and politically divisive buildings into a new arts and heritage center. Yep, we're talking about the King Louie Bowling Alley. Should the public be concerned about that? Barbara?
Well, I think that was not a wise purchase on the part of the Johnson County Commission several
years ago.
And
now to spend $22 million more?
And now to put $22 million more into it. On the other hand, they own it, and they need to do something with it at this point. So it's just a matter of at what point do you cut your losses.
But the critics were calling this the biggest boondoggle in Johnson County history, Dave. Is that too much?
Pretty big boondoggle, particularly now they're saying you can go there to vote early. I don't understand why we need $20 million for that. I think this will be an issue in Johnson County for some time to come because it sticks out so much.
Okay. And that is our Week in Review. Our thanks to Patrick Tuohey and Eric Wesson, and from the Kansas City Star, Barbara Shelley and Dave Helling. I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at KCPT, thanks for spending part of your weekend with us.